So welcome students. So let us start. So in continuation to our last topic, let us now discuss one property, that is, so how we can find the limit of a function, complex function, with respect to two real functions. That means, you know, f of z equal to u x y plus I v x y, right? Now you have this concept, limit z tends to z naught f of z equal to L. Now there is a theorem to find this limit is equivalent or implied and by implied is equal to limit x y tends to x naught y naught u x y is equal to u naught and limit x y tends to x naught y naught v x y equal to v naught. Okay, so that means if f of z equal to u x y plus I v x y, if f of z is can be written in this form, u x y plus I v x y, okay, and there is a point z naught. Z naught means what? X naught plus I y naught. Okay, and this limit L is of the form u naught plus I v naught. Okay, L is a complex number, that is of the form u naught plus I v naught, and z naught is a complex number of the form x naught plus I y naught. So u naught z means what? X plus I y. So this can be written as x y. This tends to z naught means x naught comma y naught. Now f of z equal to L, because limit is unique, so that means this real part of f, that is u x y, this all tends to u naught. That means limit real part of L, and imaginary part of f, that is v x y, that will tend to imaginary part of L, that is v naught. Okay, so that means finding this limit z tends to z naught f of z equal to L is equivalent to finding these two limits, right? Limit x y tends to x naught y naught u x y equal to u naught, and limit x y tends to x naught y naught v x y equal to v naught. So okay, this is very useful theorem, okay, for your future purpose also. Now let us do one problem regarding this. Suppose you need to find this limit z tends to 1 plus I z square plus I. So what is your f of z? Here f of z is z square plus I, right? So after expanding x plus I y whole square plus I, we get what? X square minus y square plus twice x y plus 1 into I. So using this theorem, using the above theorem, f of z is written in the form at u x y plus I v x y, right? So this is written in the form u x y plus I v x y. Now what is u x y? U x y is x square minus y square. And what is v x y? So v x y is twice x y plus 1. Okay, now what is z naught here? Z naught is 1 plus I. So what is x naught and y naught? So x naught is basically 1 and y naught is also 1, right? Now what we need to find? We need to find u naught, right? We need to find L, is not it? Limit z tends to z naught f of z equal to L, and L is of the form u naught plus I v naught. Now what we need to find? U naught and v naught. Now u naught is what? Limit x y tends to x naught y naught, okay, that is u x y, right? So limit x y tends to x naught y naught means 1 comma 1, and what is u x y? That is x square minus y square, right? Now if you put the value, so this will be what? 1 square minus 1 square, that is 0, isn't it? And that is your u naught value. So u naught value is 0. And what is v naught value? So v naught equal to limit x y tends to x naught y naught v x y. Okay, so this is what limit x y tends to x naught y naught means 1 comma 1, and what is v x y? Twice x y plus 1. So this is a polynomial function, so we just directly put the value. So 2 plus 1 is equal to 3. So what is L here? L means u naught plus I v naught, right? So 0 plus 3i. So answer is 3i here. So this is very effective theorem by which you can find the values, right? So there are some properties of complex limits that you know already. So let me recap. If limit z tends to z naught f of z equal to L, and limit z tends to z naught g of z equal to m, then first of all, limit z tends to z naught c of f of z is equal to cl, where c is any complex number, right? Next, limit z tends to z naught f of z plus minus g of z is equal to, we can separate this addition and subtraction. So basically limit z tends to z naught f of z plus minus limit z tends to z naught g of z, so L plus minus M. Clear? So there are some other, like multiplication can be separated and division is also separated, provided the denominator should be not equal to 0. Okay. Now, what is the definition for continuity of a complex function? So this L that we have we need to find, that L should be equal to functional value where it is approaches. Means limit z tends to z naught f of z should be equal to f of z naught. Okay, so limit f z tends to z naught f of z should be equal to f of z naught. Okay, so a function f is continuous at a point if limit z tends to z naught f of z should be equal to f of z. So criteria for continuity at a point means what? A complex function f is said to be continuous at a point z naught if each of the following three conditions hold. Three conditions must be satisfied. So what are the conditions? First of all, this limit should be exist. That means limit z tends to z naught f of z should be exist. F is defined at the point z naught, right? And these two should be equal. Then we say that f is continuous at a point z naught. Okay. Now, if we take this example, f of z equal to 1 by 1 plus z square. So it is continuous, right? Except at the points for which 1 plus z square becomes 0. That means z equal to plus minus I. So f is continuous except at plus minus I. Okay, except at plus minus I. Clear? So there is another theorem, like as previous, real and imaginary parts of a continuous function. So So if f of z equal to u x y plus I v x y, okay, and z not equal to x not plus I y not, then the complex function f is continuous at the point z not. Then the complex function f is continuous at the point z naught if and only if both real functions u and v are continuous. Both real functions u and v are continuous at the point x not y not. Okay, that means f is continuous at a point z not means that if and only means what? This means this or this means this, right? So f is continuous at a point z not means both the real functions u and v are continuous at the point x not y not. Okay, and vice versa, that means if both the real functions u and v are continuous at a point x not y not, then f is continuous at the point z not, right? Okay, so there are some properties like if f and g are continuous at a point z not, then if f and g both are continuous, right, then cf is also continuous, where c is a complex constant. Then f plus minus g is also continuous. F into g is also continuous. F by g is also continuous, provided g of z should not be g at any point z not should not be equal to zero. Okay, and you know that very important property, continuity of polynomial functions. So complex polynomial functions are continuous on the entire complex plane. You have to remember these things. Okay, so complex, any complex polynomial functions, okay, any complex polynomial function, right, f of z equal to a naught plus a1 z plus a2 z square plus a3 z cube, like dot dot. So this is like any complex polynomial function. So any complex polynomial function is continuous on entire complex plane. Okay, is continuous on entire complex plane, right? Is continuous on entire complex plane. Next thing that you have to be focus is differentiability, right? So differentiability of a complex function, that is very important. So I have given you already the definition. Let me recap. A complex function f, which is defined in a neighborhood of z naught. Okay, a complex function f is defined in the neighborhood of z naught. Neighborhood, that means if it is z naught, any delta radius circle is the neighborhood of z naught. Okay, so f is defined in a neighborhood of z naught. The derivative of f, the derivative of f at the point z naught, it is denoted by f dash z naught, and is defined as, if it is defined, it should be limit delta z tends to 0 f of z naught plus delta z minus f of z naught by delta z. Okay, provided the limit exists. So first, what you need to check, f is defined in a neighborhood of z naught, first you look into this limit, right? If this limit exists, means has a finite value, then we say that f is differentiable, and its differentiable value, that is derivative of f at the point z naught, is given by f dash z naught equal to this limit value. Okay, first of all you need to have this limit to be exist, right? Then only we say that the derivative exists. Okay, so here also some derivative rule is like derivative of any constant is zero, and derivative of constant multiply of any function is like c into derivative of f of z, or c into f dash z, okay, or ddz of f of z plus minus g of z is equal to f dash z plus minus g dash z. Okay, so these are the properties, and you know that ddz of f of z g of z is equal to f of z g dash z plus g of z f dash z. So these are the properties you already know. Okay, and like these are the, this satisfies only where the derivative exists. Okay, those, for those function for which we directly say that the derivative exists. Okay, so suppose ddz of z to the power n, n is what, n is any integer. Okay, so this derivative exists, and its derivative value is what, n z to the power n minus 1. Okay, now if it is like here you have to remember one thing, this derivative should be exist, then only we can implement the derivative on the function. First condition is that the derivative should be exist, then only we can implement this derivative on the function. Okay, so there are some properties you have to look into, and also there are some functions which are nowhere differentiable. Suppose you look into this function f of z equal to x plus 4iy. Okay, so here delta z is equal to delta x plus I delta y. Okay, so first you look into this limit, limit delta z tends to 0, f of z plus delta z minus f of z by delta z. So this limit value will be what, delta z tends to 0. So f of z plus delta z, okay, so z plus delta z will be what, z plus delta z will be, means f of x plus I y, which is comes out at x is same as x and y is comes out at 4iy, right? So this will be what, x plus delta x, x plus delta x plus 4i, y will be replaced by y plus delta y, right, minus f of z, that means f of z is what, x minus 4iy divided by delta z, means delta x plus I delta y. Okay, this can be written as,
sir,
hello,
sir,
yes please,
sir, is delta z delta x plus 4 delta y or only I delta y?
Which one,
sir? Delta z,
delta z, delta z equal to
delta x plus I 4 delta y or only I delta y?
No, no, this is like, see, f of z is what given, f of z outcome, you know, for the morning class, like z is our input, so z is what, x plus I y, right, and what is our output, output is x plus 4 I y. Now delta z is what? Delta z our input, right? Change in x. Na? Z is what? Z is x plus I y, right? This is z. This is not f of z. I am not talking about, you are talking about f of z value. I am not talking about f of z value. I am talking about z value. So z value is what? X plus I y. Z value is x plus I y, right?
Yes, sir.
X is z, x plus I y. So what will be delta x? Delta z. Delta z will be delta x plus I delta y. I am talking about z only. Means your opinion, then z plus delta z will be what? Z plus delta z will be x plus delta x plus I of y plus delta y. Now we have to take f of z plus delta z, right? Now f of z plus delta z will be, x will be same and y part will be 4 times, right? So 4 I of y plus delta y, that I have written here.
Okay, clear? Thank you, sir.
So like limit delta z tends to 0, f of z plus delta z means x plus delta x plus 4 I of y plus delta y minus f of z, right? So f of z is given x plus 4 I y. So here will be minus x minus 4 I y divided by delta z means delta x plus I delta y. Okay, so x will be cancelled. Then 4 I y will be cancelled. So what will be there? Limit delta z tends to 0, delta x plus 4 I delta y, and here will be delta x plus I delta y, right? Now you see, we have to think about this limit only, right? We need to check whether this limit exists or not. Okay, now if we choose two paths, okay, parallel to x-axis, any line, first one is what? Any line, okay, or we can write like this: if we let delta z tends to 0 along a line parallel to the x-axis, parallel to the x-axis, then what do we get? Then parallel to x-axis means what? Y will be what? 0. See, any line along x-axis, along x-axis or parallel to y-axis. See, if this line is there, that is parallel to x-axis. So here y will be fixed, right? Y will be fixed. Now change in y will be what? 0, right? Delta y means what? Change in y. So change in y is 0, right? Because y is fixed. If we let delta z tends to 0 along a line parallel to the x-axis. So consider this line. Here x is variable, right? Because x is changing, but y is constant here. So if y is fixed here, what will be change? Change in y will be 0. Delta y means what? Change in y, right? That means first of suppose it, at this point it is 2 or at this point it is 4, then only we have the delta y equal to 2. But here, since for every point y is fixed, so its change will be 0. That means delta y will be 0. So along this line, what will be our limit? So basically delta z will be delta x, right? Delta z will be delta x. So now what we can write? we can write the limit delta z is now delta x, so delta x tends to 0, so delta y 0, so delta x by delta x, that is 1. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, if we let delta z tends to 0 along a line parallel to y axis. Okay, so parallel to y axis. So parallel to y axis means like this way. So here, what will we fix here? X is fixed. So if x is fixed, what is its change? Change is 0, right? That means delta x 0. So delta z will be what? I delta y, right? Delta z will be I delta y. Now, if delta z equal to I delta y, so what we can say about this limit? Limit, now delta z tends to 0 means I delta y tends to 0. So we can write delta y tends to 0. And see from here, this was what? Delta x. Now delta x is 0. So 4i delta y by I delta y, right? This will be what? 4i delta y by delta I delta y. So I delta y cancel. This will be 4. So we get two values, right? One is 1, another is 4. So 1 is not equal to 4 because we get two different limit along two different path, and therefore limit does not exist. Limit does not exist. So if limit does not exist, that means function is not differentiable at any point because our z naught is arbitrary. Na? See from here. This is the definition of differentiation. So yeah, so each is our f of z, okay, f of z x plus I y, x plus 4 I y. Now we have taken any z, for any value z we are calculating this derivative, and this limit does not exist. That means what? Derivative does not exist, right? So if derivative does not exist and z, the point itself is arbitrary, hence the derivative, hence the function is not differentiable at any point, or we can say it is nowhere differentiable. Clear? It is nowhere differentiable. Now, associated with differentiable, there is another concept that is called analytic function. So basically, what do you mean analytic function? So a complex function w equal to f of z is said to be analytic, at a point z naught if f is two condition, f is differentiable at z naught, also this is adding condition, also f is differentiable in some neighborhood of z naught. That means if we take any point z naught and take any circle, we center a z naught radius delta radius circle. So it is a neighborhood of z naught, right? It is a neighborhood of z naught. So for analytic function, a function w equal to f of z is said to be analytic at a point z naught if it is differentiable at this point z naught and also in the neighborhood point of z naught Okay, so a function f is analytic in a domain. This is for at a point, right? This is a definition for at a point z naught. Now a function f is said to be analytic in a domain D if it is analytic at every point in D. If it is analytic at every point in D. Okay, so F is analytic in a domain D means F is analytic at every point in D. Okay, clear? Next, another concept is that we use the concept regular. Okay, so regular and holomorphic are two synonyms for analytic function. Okay, regular function means analytic function, or holomorphic means analytic function. These two are synonyms for analytic function. Okay. Now you check whether f of z equal to mod z square, where it is differentiable. Let us check this differentiability of this function f of z equal to mod z square. Okay, so we need to first find what limit, right? Limit delta z tends to 0. So at any point, suppose z naught plus delta z minus f of z naught by delta z. Now this will be what? Limit delta z tends to 0. So this is like mod of z naught. So this is what? Mod z square means z into z bar. You know, na? Z into z bar. So this is, we can write like z naught. This is now z. So z naught plus delta z into z naught plus delta z bar minus f of z naught means z naught into z naught bar, okay, divided by delta z. Now this is what? Limit delta z tends to 0. So we have z naught plus delta z, and z1 plus z2 whole bar means z1 bar plus z2 bar minus z naught. This will be z naught into z naught bar, which is not whole bar. This is like z naught into z naught bar divided by delta z. So limit delta z tends to 0, multiplying, what we get? Z naught bar plus z naught delta z bar plus z naught bar delta z plus delta z bar minus z naught bar whole divided by delta z. Whole divided by delta z. Now this can be written as what? Limit delta z tends to 0. This is cancelled. These two terms cancel. So we can also divide, right? So what we get directly, we can write z naught bar plus delta z bar plus z naught delta z bar by delta z, right? Okay. Clear? Now you see, when this limit exists, this is a number, right? Z naught bar plus delta z. We don't have any problem up to this. But here we have problem, right? Here we have problem because we know along x-axis, this value is 1. Along y-axis, this value is minus 1. Clear? Along x-axis, this value is 1. And along y-axis, this value is minus 1. So this is equal only when our z is 0. When z is 0, both the delta z and delta z bar is becomes, when z is approaching to 0, okay, this has some value, that means 1. That means this limit exists. Okay, so that means what we can say, f of z equal to mod z square is differentiable only at the point z equal to 0. Only at the point z equal to 0. Clear? Is differentiable only at the point z equal to 0. But is not differentiable anywhere else. Okay, that means what? It is nowhere analytic, right? Because for analytic, it should be differentiable at a particular point, also in the neighborhood. But here it is differentiable only at the point z equal to 0. Okay, so what we can say? F is nowhere analytic, right? Now you can check for this function f of z equal to z square. This is differentiable everywhere and hence it is analytic everywhere. Hence it is analytic everywhere. Clear? Any doubt?
No, sir.
Sir, that how it is differentiable at z equal to 0, sir? Please explain once.
See. So let me just. Delete this part. So we are now checking what along x axis, right? So along x axis delta y will be 0, right? So delta z will be what? Delta x, and delta z bar will be, delta z bar will be what? Delta x, right? So what is the limit value here? This limit value will be 1. Along y axis delta x will be 0, right? So delta z will be i delta y. So delta z bar will be minus I delta Y. So this value will be minus 1. So along Z tends to 0, we get two different values, right? One is plus 1, one is minus 1. That means this limit delta that tends to 0. That means what? Just a second. So what we get, see, along x-axis, what is its value? Means derivative value. Z naught bar plus delta z bar plus z naught, right? Clear? Clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Because
yes, sir.
Along x-axis, this value is 1, right? Now, along y-axis. So along y-axis, what is the value? Along y-axis, z naught bar plus delta z bar minus z naught, right? Clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is two different values.
Two different values. So, but when, that means we get two different values, right? We get two different values except when z naught is equal to 0. When z naught equal to 0, this becomes 0, this becomes 0, this becomes 0. So our value will be 0. Okay? Here also our value will be 0. So for along x-axis, along y-axis, we get the same values, 0. When z naught equal to 0. But if z naught is not equal to 0, for any other values, these two are not equal, right? Clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Clear?
Yes, sir. Now it's clear, sir. It is only different zero.
That means these two values are equal only when z naught is zero, right? That means our what we can say, the f is differentiable only at z equal to 0, nowhere else. Okay, that means it is not analytic.
Yes,
it is not analytic.
Yes, sir.
Clear?
Yes, sir, it's
okay,
clear.
Fine. Okay, so similarly in the same fashion, you can find for this function f of z equal to z bar. It is not differentiable at any point. Our previous problem, f of z equal to mod z square, f of z equal to mod z square was differentiable at z equal to 0. But this function is nowhere differentiable. Just a one line answer. Can you give me? This is like one line answer. If you look into this limit, what do you get? Just a second. Is my screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
So f of z equal to z bar, for f of z equal to z bar, if we look into this limit, limit delta z tends to 0, f of z naught plus delta z minus f of z naught by delta z. So limit delta z tends to 0, this will be z naught plus delta z whole bar by z naught bar by delta z. Now this will be what? Limit delta z tends to 0, this is like z naught bar plus delta z bar minus z naught bar by delta z. So bar cancel. So what? Delta z tends to 0, delta z bar by delta z, right? That means limit delta x delta y tends to 0, 0, delta x plus I delta y, sorry, this will be minus, this will be minus, and this will be plus. Now along x-axis this will be 1, along y-axis this will be minus 1. So we don't have any, like earlier we get z naught, right? But here for any value, this is not depend on z. For any value we have got 1 and minus 1. That means what? It is nowhere differentiable. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Sir, at 0,
Yes.
sir, at 0, what will happen?
No, see, at zero there is no any point. Like, see, where is the difference? Where is the difference in the previous problem in here? Here, this was the value, right? Z naught bar plus z naught was multiplied. Here is what? There is no z naught multiply, right? Z naught into this delta z bar by delta z. So that is, although this is plus one minus one, but there is one z naught multiply, right? For that, whenever you put z naught value zero, these two become zero, right? But here the values are not depends on any z naught, right? Here the values are not depends on any z naught. So directly if we get one and minus one, that means what? The values are different. That means the limit does not exist. That means function is not differentiable anywhere. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next thing is Cauchy-Riemann equation. So Cauchy-Riemann equation suggests to what? If f of z equal to uxy plus ivxy, okay, is differentiable at a point z equal to x plus iy, if and only if the partial differentiation of u with respect to x, that is ux, should be equal to vy and uy should be equal to minus vx. Okay? That means f of z equal to uxy plus ivxy is differentiable at a point z. If it is differentiable at a point z equal to x plus iy, then CR equation satisfies, then this is called CR equation. Okay, then CR equation satisfied. Otherwise, in other words, if CR equation satisfied, that means f of z is differentiable. So these are vice versa. Okay, means if always if f is differentiable, that means CR equation satisfied, or we can say if CR equation satisfied, that means function is differentiable. These two are vice and versa properties. If one implies another, and another implies original one. Okay, f is differentiable implies CR equation satisfied. Similarly, CR equation satisfied means f is differentiable. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now you know differentiability. If a function, you just see the previous problem. F is differentiable at z equal to 0, only at the point z equal to 0. That means what? F is not analytic, right? If a function is differentiable at a point 0, this means what? Function is not analytic, because it should be differentiable at some neighborhood points, which does not follows. That means f is not differentiable, f is not analytic. That means what we can say? This CR equation satisfies means differentiability only, but we cannot say function is analytic. Okay, for function to be analytic, it should be differentiable at some neighborhood points also. Clear? Clear your concept?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now
Yes, sir.
we look some problems. So see these problems. F of z equal to twice x square plus y plus I of y square minus x. Okay, So what is u x y? U x y equal to twice x square plus y, and what is v x y? Y square minus x. Now u x is what? 4x. U y is 1. V x is minus 1. V y is 2y. Right? Now see, u x is v y. No. U x not equal to v y. Okay. Although u y is equal to minus v x. Right? But since this is not equal to, this implies what? CR equation not satisfied, right? Not satisfied. So CR equation not satisfied means f is not differentiable, right? So f is not differentiable implies f is not analytic anywhere. Anywhere. So what you can say, our given function f is nowhere analytic, or f is not analytic at any point. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, so these are the some problems you have to solve. Okay, in exam also this type of problem would arise. So I think you have understood all these concepts.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if you have any doubt, you can ask me. Otherwise, we can stop here and study well. Okay, so these are the problems, and the question will be based on these concepts only, so you can study the concept. Okay.
Okay, sir.